Sermons are in this format. A lot of sermons all over. And I think, in my opinion, part of that is, you know, it's partly to elicit some guilt in the matter. And I'm not saying it's good or bad, I'm just saying that's how sort of a lot of things go. But in a sense, the authors are saying this is the theology they're writing on in terms of guilt. So, quote, "You've ruined the party for all of us with your behavior. I can't show my face to my friends." So with that, you made someone feel guilty, right? The person. Number two, "How can you be so selfish as to not lend me the money?" So that's putting guilt on someone too, right? In a way. Or, "After all I've done for you, you can't even come home for Christmas."
This is mom guilt.
"Shame on you for saying that to her." So, not just guilt, but shame. So I guess partly what he's saying is, you know, the standard sermon format for a lot of people is, God says do this, you're not doing this, you should do that. So that's guilt, or guilt of shame. "There's plenty of people out there who need your help, and you're going on a vacation?" "What am I supposed to do with myself if you can't go?" "You should have licked that eating disorder by now." So it's your issue, your problem. "You should really visit them. They're your parents, you know." So, I don't know. You sometimes hear these things, you know, people putting guilt.
Pressure.
And I don't know if sometimes church does that, you know, does the church sometimes say this or that, and you should do that.
Sometimes.
And I'm not making a judgment as to whether it's right or wrong. I'm just saying, you know, what the authors are saying. Sometimes?
Yeah, sometimes you feel guilty if you can't do something you know you should do.
Yeah.
It's not like saying to somebody else. I think it's in our thoughts, you know, especially the first one. There's plenty of people out there who need your help.
And you're going on vacation.
Much for the church. Because churches, we have service on Sundays and like on the weekend. And for some people, they feel like, oh, they need a break, say, like, vacation. And, well, some of those people have responsibilities in church.
"I'll be back."
"Oh, yeah, somebody's going away."
"By the service, I promise."
So, okay. So, again, he's going to veer towards a certain direction. And although it's going to be helpful. So just bear with where he's going. "The guilt trip may make you think, I feel guilty. I assume I have sinned. If I confess to God, you know, God will forgive. And if I confess, I'll feel less guilty. And then I go on with my life until next time when someone makes me feel guilty." So it's kind of like a cycle. So that's sort of what can happen sometimes, which speaks to what you said earlier, because it's like you said, you know, you can confess and not feel guilty, but at the same time you're guilty that you're going to commit the same thing again later. You know, you know, we do repeat sins, we do, you know, that does happen. So it doubles in the guilt, in a way.
People in my church in Thailand, they often use the word term, well, if translated to English, it might be a disgusting cycle or something.
It what?
Yeah, like a cycle of like doing the same,
the same thing.
Same cycle. Over. Maybe not that word, and not disgusting, but something like the synonym of it. Mm-hmm. That word might be too extreme, but yeah.
Okay. So, but what the interesting part is he's showing is that there is an issue. You know, you can feel guilty, but what if you're actually not guilty?
Yeah.
That can happen,
sure.
Right?
Yeah, you bring it on yourself sometimes.
Mm. Or people put it on you.
So he comes up with this, two meanings of guilt. It could be the state of having done something wrong. You know, it's like a status. You've obviously done something wrong. You stole a car. That means you're guilty of that. That's separate from the feeling. The feeling is the feeling of self-reproach you're having because of the belief that you've done something wrong. It may not necessarily mean you've done something wrong, but you could have a belief that you've done something wrong. So you feel guilty for not coming home this Christmas. So it's a separate issue, you know, the state, the actual status that you're guilty, or your feeling of being guilty. Have you ever thought of it that way, kind of just separating that, those two issues? Because it's kind of like, have you felt like people have made you feel guilty for something you didn't do?
Mm-hmm.
So there's issues like that too, that you need to consider. So what he's saying is, you know, feelings aren't necessarily the best indicator of whether, you know, are you actually guilty or not? So what do you think of that? What do you think of that thought? You know, your feelings are not the most reliable in terms of, you know, you feel guilty, but what if in reality you're not? And
for the second example, I feel guilty for not coming home this Christmas. I mean, if you really didn't go home for Christmas, then you are guilty of that. But then it becomes is that necessarily a bad thing?
Right.
So true that if you didn't do this thing, you can even say that's a state, like you didn't do it, right?
Right.
That's a fact. But then you have to interpret whether or not that's actually wrong and you should feel bad about it.
Right. And it's possible that you are guilty inside and you are guilty in terms of the state, your status. Both can happen at the same time. But it's also possible what he's trying to do is tell us, what if the status is different from our feeling?
I was going to add something. I was thinking that guiltiness is created by several, by values.
Values.
Family values.
Okay.
Religious values, the society values. So it starts creating certain things that makes us feel like, like the family value for Christmas. Christmas is a very important date that you have to be with your family.
Mm-hmm.
So somebody in your family is going to create that kind of heavy pressure.
Right. So it's certain, like a value, yeah. So there's a certain standard that people can put up and say, you know, this is how you know whether you're guilty or not, because this is your expectation that you need to do. If you don't do that, the status is you're guilty.
And again, maybe you have to travel a long way, maybe you don't have money to go, maybe there's some underlying reason that you shouldn't really feel guilty about it.
So that can happen too.
For me, I would follow my own feeling. Because I don't want to, you know, take a chance of being guilty or not guilty. If I feel guilty, I'm just not going to ignore it. I would try to do my best just to follow my feelings, so I won't feel bad later.
Yeah, and I think for a lot of us, we do sort of follow up our feeling, right?
Right. For example,
for the most part,
for me, so many times with the Bible, the book itself. For some people, it depends on the person. I value the Bible. I mean, the actual Bible, the book. If I don't place the Bible on the floor, because I tend to value it as like it's the word from the Lord, so I try not to put the Bible. But for the society, I don't know. For other people, might feel like, oh, it's just a book.
Right.
But for me, I value it as it's the word from the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't place the Bible on the floor. So if I do it, I would feel guilty.
That's a little cultural, I think.
That is very cultural.
That's cultural because I wouldn't think that way.
I mean, so the issue becomes, you know, what is the value that we need to, you know, to look at to figure out whether we're guilty or not, or is there such a thing, or how come there's so many different things to consider, culture.
For that, that doesn't mean that I value the book, but I value the word from the Lord. If I disrespect the book, meaning that I disrespect God, that's me. I'm not judging you, just saying that, that's me.
Okay.
I might put it on the floor so I remember to read it. So when I get up, it's there.
So you can see the different, you know, cultural.
Yeah, that's not a book. That's why I'm saying that. I'm not going to tell that, oh, if you place it on the floor, that you're guilty. Because that's me. I follow the thing that I feel. If you don't have that feeling, then you're not guilty for that, because you don't have that thought of, you know, the two things that are in your head, that should I do it, should I not do it, should I ignore that I place the Bible on the floor, you know. But if you don't have that intention, you know, you just put it because you think you're going to read it later, or you don't value it as much as, I mean, not I'm not saying that, I'm sorry. I mean, you don't think it as, you know, you have to, I'm sorry, that's the cultural thing. Yeah.
Is the conflict of, like, you're placing your values on someone else and expecting them to meet those values, and that's what causes the guilt?
I feel the same as Thai culture, during the week I listen to the preaching, I started the preaching through YouTube, and I kind of exercise in the amen. I lift up my foot against the voice from the my iPad, iPhone, and suddenly I feel it's not good for me to lift up the feet against the voice when the preaching. I turn my leg to the opposite side.
Oh, it's the feet, yeah. Okay, all right. It's the Thai thing, yeah.
Yeah, it's the Thai culture.
Yeah, but don't get us wrong. We don't, when we see people do that, like American people do that, we don't judge them that they are doing
it's
the wrong thing.
You're here.
Do it wrong. I mean, even if American people put this out, I don't judge them because they have different, like, yeah. And they don't have the same feeling as we do. So it's different people with different culture.
Yeah.
If I still do it, I see them and I follow the way they do, I would feel guilty because I do have that feeling. And I'm gonna ignore that, and I feel guilty.
If an American goes to Thailand and he's gonna live there, I mean, out of respect, he should eventually learn to kind of along with
that.
Well, you do. Well, you do. Comes out of respect to him. Yeah. And people are gonna, maybe you wouldn't, but I'm sure other people would, like, have ill thoughts or something. Person, like, isn't respecting.
And once again, I might don't feel that they're doing bad thing, but I would appreciate it more if they follow our culture. Right. Just that. I don't feel that they're doing something wrong, but I would appreciate that they do same thing.
Okay.
Yeah, when you're sitting on the floor in Thailand and then they're all fussy about where your feet are, it's kind of like, okay, I'll try. You know, because they sit on the floor when they eat. Mm-hmm. At least in the village they do.
Yeah.
All right, so again, that's, you know, we're talking about culture and all that. We'll move back to what about spiritual? What about the Bible? What does it say? In the Bible, guilt is the state and not the feeling. Meaning it's the status, that's what it's saying. It considers more that instead of the feeling. In Ezekiel, you become guilty because of the blood you have shed. So there's a reason. It's not about the feeling. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God because of sin, because of the status, because of what Adam and Eve did. It's a status. We have sin. So we're already pronounced guilty. So it's not even a feeling. You know, it's because of where we're at in our relationship with the law. You know, because all of us have broken the law at some point. You know, God's law. It doesn't matter if we've already followed everything to the T, but at some point later we could have violated a single one, you know, a minor one, and it's still guilty, even if you followed majority or most of it, most of your life. So regardless of the feeling, it's an issue of a state. Now, he goes to the feelings. Now, where do the feelings come from? He's saying it comes from the conscience, our conscience, which is condemning us and telling us that we're bad. For example, if we have pain, you know, it's a painful feeling causing us to criticize and condemn others, you know, if our conscience acts up in that. Maybe our actions have hurt someone or consumed another person's time. Like our conscience would say, oh, you know, I've taken up too much of your time. You feel a little guilty in that. Or we disappointed someone with our imperfection. So it's a conscience controlled kind of thing. At least that's what he's arguing. So he's separating that from the state. Instead, he's pinpointing that all of us have individual consciences, right? And this is my ad lib, and it's conditioned by so many things, right? Culture, education, background, whatever, spiritual upbringing. So the it's in the conscience, in terms of where the feeling comes from.
Sorry, what is the state again?
This
that you did.
Uh-huh. That you did it.
You broke the law.
Yeah.
It's a fact that you did something wrong.
Mm-hmm.
You broke the law. You broke God's law.
Like if, you know, if God says, these are the Ten Commandments, and you broke one of them. You're guilty, regardless of how you feel about it, right? That's the state. You know, you may feel indifferent about it, or you may feel disastrous about it.
That's hard to define, like, every single state, like, which one is wrong, which one is not.
Yeah, or a third option is, oh, I need God. You can feel that.
Yeah.
You know, I can't live life by myself, by my own will, because, you know, I'm guilty before God. So I don't know, I'm just giving you options of how people might feel. I'm gonna go quickly to shame. Shame is a little different. It's both a state and a feeling. So, you could feel shame, for example, you know, you feel like you're being despised by others. It's a good biblical example. Joseph didn't want Mary to be publicly shamed that she was pregnant out of wedlock. So she wanted, Joseph would wanted to divorce her quietly instead. So it's not public knowledge. Because it is, especially at that time, it's a shame. It's a big shame if you're